Hello and good evening, everyone. I'm Hasna V, Secretary IEEE MEA SB. I extend my warm welcome to everyone present here joining for this session conducted as a part of VivaCity V Week 2021. Our special guest for the day is Ms. Aisha Nazia on the topic Women in Engineering and Endless Opportunities. Before heading on, I would like to remind the audience to keep their microphones muted throughout the session. Any queries may be posted in the chat box and the speaker may attend them during the session or at the end of it. Also, the participants, please make sure you fill the feedback form at the end of this session to avail the certificate. Now, without further ado, I would like to call upon Ms. Krishna, Membership Development Coordinator, for the welcome address. Over to you, Krishna.
Hello, good evening, everyone. Myself, Krishna, We Membership Development Coordinator, IEEE-MESC. It's my pleasure to extend a cheerful welcome to you all for joining today's talk session on the topic Women in Engineering and Endless Opportunities. First of all, I would like to invite our beloved speaker for the day, Ms. Aisha Nazia. Ms. Aisha, an alumni of TKM College of Engineering, Kollam, is a BTech graduate in Mechanical Engineering. She has always been an active IEEE member and has served at various positions. She is also a football enthusiast and a former player. She has volunteered at various sports leagues like the FIFA Under 17, ISL, etc. She is a constant advocate of sustainability and is a co-founder of an organization called Start Change Today. We feel privileged and extremely happy to welcome you to the session, ma'am. Also, I would like to welcome our V advisor, Dr. SB Councillor Jamshir Sir, SB Chairperson Mr. Mohammed Mushraf, V Chairperson MESB Ms. Shafnaz, V Chairperson of Armula College SB Ms. Swati, and V Chairperson of GC Idukki SB Ms. Shivani. Last but not least, I gladly welcome all the participants that have joined with us today. Welcome to all. Now, without further delay, I'd like to hand over the session to our speaker, Ms. Aisha Nazia. Ma'am, please.
Hello, everyone. Could someone confirm if you can see me and hear me?
Yes, ma'am, it's clear.
Okay, thank you. Good evening, everyone. I'm sure all of you are home. So many days of doing online classes and webinars and all of that. So today's conversation that I want to have with you is not really more like another educational process. I just want to have, though it's a webinar, I will try my best to have a very normal conversation about things that I realized in my life. Being an engineering student, the opportunities that I was unaware of because of, you know, one's own self awareness, lack of self-awareness, because I don't feel like it is possible to blame it on somebody, like say my institution or my, you know, the organizations that I've been part of. So yeah, I hope you guys are going to enjoy the next 1 hour. You know, if at all you guys get some information from whatever I'm sharing today, I would be really happy that I could do that amidst all of these things that we are all part of. I'm going to share my screen. Just let me know on chat or by voice if you can see my screen. Yeah, can you see my screen?
Yeah, the screen's visible.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so I was trying to talk to the organizers of the event to understand, you know, what should I talk about? And because it's a WIE event, they told me to talk about women in engineering and in general about opportunities and things women in engineering could do. Firstly, a disclaimer, I do not see anything specific for women in engineering as such. But then I would like to shed light on things generally that most women tend not to do, maybe because of the societal pressure or, you know, because of how we are put across about, okay, these are the things that you can achieve in, or these are the things that you must do. So I felt in general, I will speak about these scenarios. And in the process, if you have any questions, please don't shy away. You can put it on the chat. I will try to answer as much as possible after I finish my presentation. Okay, to start off with, like I said, to anybody that I say is that the first stage of even understanding what we want to do is about discovering oneself. I'm sure most of you would have seen it on social media or, you know, multiple number of platforms that we are part of where, you know, motivational things like this would be written, right? Which is discover yourself, do that, do this. But then the question is, do we really know how to discover ourselves, right? I used to wonder this every time somebody told me this, discover yourself, find what is your passion, find what you like doing. And this pretty much started towards the late days of schooling, right? Like once you become a teenager, once you cross your eighth grade, your parents, the society, your teachers, everybody is curious to know what do you want to become. And that is when this kind of question instilled in me, thinking of what exactly do I want to, like, there's so many things in my head. Someday I feel like I want to be a pilot. The other day I feel like, okay, I want to be a mechanical engineer. The very next day I feel like, okay, I want to do something related to football. So I'm like, it used to meddle up so much in my head that I used to get really confused. So, like people who have listened, I don't know how many of you would have attended my webinars before, but this is something that I tell everybody, that sometime when I was in my 11th grade and the whole world was going gaga about engineering entrance, medical entrance, that, this, I really didn't know, like, you know, what to focus on. Okay, just because you study and just because you get good marks doesn't necessarily mean that this is what you have to do. So that's when I happened to find this book called Ikigai. So I don't read books, but then I apparently found this in the top 10 reads. And it's a book which is called Ikigai. And the, you know, the concept is, you know, the Japanese secret to a long and happy life is what the book's tagline said. So I was like, you know, these Japanese guys, for me, for some reason, because I like automobile, because I like cars, I've always been following how the Japanese culture is. And I felt that this is something that somebody like me should try, because nobody has ever told me about this. Nobody in my school, none of my parents or anybody told me about such a thing, that there is something like this which you can try. So back then, because I was in school and, you know, we used to have all these color pencils and chart papers at home, I tried drawing this chart on, you know, a paper, and I tried writing things. You know, so you have to make a chart like this and you have to write things like what we love. So what we love is basically what do you love doing or what is your passion. So in most columns, I didn't even know what to write, because back then as 11th grade student, I didn't even understand what means by what is your vocation or what is your mission, what do you want to become professionally. And I was confused between what is passion and what is love and what is paid for. But somewhere, you know, I scribbled certain things, and you know, that really pushed me hard to understand myself better. If you ask me, that some an Ikigai chart that I made in 11th grade, which was like in 2010, and what I write today is like miles apart. But I have realized that eventually in due course of time, my chart has helped me discover myself better. So every time I rewrite the chart, I do not cut away what I have written. That is there. I make a new chart, I add points to it. I make a new chart, I cancel some points that I've written. So for me, this pretty much has been a process of iterating what I really feel. So this is something that I want all of you to take up as an action item. If you really feel you want to do it, I'm not forcing this on anybody. It's up to each of us to understand what do you really want to do, right? So the thing is, personal growth to me is not one particular thing. It's a combination of a lot of things that happens to us. And to identify this lot of things is why I keep telling people that you have to truly discover what you really want, right? Most of us might like something, might not like something. Even if you're part of an engineering degree, you're going to study, I think, 40 to 45 papers, keeping aside all your labs and other things. So these 40 to 45 papers are all different subjects, different concepts. So it is very important that it is okay for you to not like few things and like few things, right? Just because it's part of your curriculum doesn't mean that you have to hardcore flow into it. There are so many papers in my engineering degree. I just wrote it because I have to pass or get a mark so that it does not affect my grade. I had no interest in that thing, and that's totally fine. And this is a part and parcel of everything that we do. We just get into a job doesn't mean we like every part of that job. But because any kind of project management or any kind of educational course comes with a holistic approach, we have to go through this. And so is the case with personal growth as well, as what I feel, where there are things that we have to focus. There is no going the other way around with it. Like, for example, a lot of us in India, we do not have the routine of fitness, right? Like, which is going for a walk every day or going for a run in the morning. That's a very Western culture. But these days, I see a lot of people focus on that. So in a way, I feel it's a very holistic approach of how we go about it. And it's also our, you know, our view on how we want to look at it. So one thing that I've realized, and I keep using this picture wherever possible, is that anything you do, right, in the beginning, it's kind of an easy thing. Once you go a little advanced, it becomes a little difficult. And once you go ahead, it just becomes more difficult. But what happens is, in the process, you also grow. So this is just like how you play video games or anything, right? There's the level one, there's level two, there's level three. So it just gets difficult. But because you have conquered level one and level two, there's some learning that's happened, and that makes you better for a level three. So what I tell people is, no matter who it is, right, this kind of a journey or this kind of a road is going to be same, irrespective of whether you're privileged, whether you're lucky, whether you're extra talented, whether you're super smart. It all depends on how your car is. So when I say car, it's us, like how you are in terms of how you want to conquer this. So now when I say all of this, the question is, okay, how do I access such things? Okay, you told us that personal growth is important. You told us that, you know, there has to be a holistic approach of how to get better or how to look at things. But where is the access? Where do we get it? So to just give you a stats of numbers, right, a survey that happened in 2019, back when things were normal, that's even before pandemic, that's even before social media hit so high, that's even before people sat in isolation. The whole, you know, number survey gave out these numbers, which is, there are 500 million internet users in our country. So which means you, I, all of us fall into this 500 million. There are 450 million plus smartphone users. Definitely me, yourself, all of us again fall into that same bucket. And there are 1 out of 3 Indian who watches a online video. So then again, you and me, we fall into the same bucket. So, you know, when digital is the new future, it is also important that we subscribe to that format of lifestyle. There is no point by saying that, okay, I'm not a social media person, I don't want to be on social media. You have to be on social media for what your choice of doing things is. Okay, if you like dancing, you be on so-and-so platform. If you like writing, you be on, say, a Medium or a Quora. If you are somebody who wants to get engaged in conversation, have an account on Reddit. If you're somebody who does crafts and you want to put up your pictures, if you're somebody who likes designing things, go to Pinterest and do it. So I feel digital presence is something which is inevitable. And the most important thing is, just because there is a need of digital presence doesn't mean that you go there and do whatever you want. Just like how you go to a school, there's basics, right? You have to wear a uniform. You cannot comb your hair in such a way. There's a particular way that you come. You know, the reason why we do all of this is also because, you know, we want ourselves to be presentable. So even on social media, it's important to maintain that presence of yours, right? You can't just loiter around there. That's like, you're the brand. Like, your social media profile or the way you behave on social media shows who you are. And today the connectivity is so high that even I just open the participant list today, I take one name and I type it on any of the social media, I have access to so much about you, irrespective of knowing you in person. So for me, though there are multiple forms of social media platforms available, each of it has its own usage. What I see in current generation is everybody's doing everything on all social media. No, it is not like that. If Facebook is for a purpose, LinkedIn is for a different purpose. If Instagram has a purpose, then Twitter is for a different purpose. Similarly, a lot more social media. I don't know how many of you use more than these. These are the common ones. Hence, I used that to depict the picture. But then in general, I feel the way you tend to use social media clearly depends on how you gain information. Like, I clearly use LinkedIn to make sure that I make work-related connections. I read a lot about things that I don't get otherwise. Maybe I use an Instagram to read more about, you know, traveling to places or seeing good places, or, you know, that's not my information portal, right? I see a lot of people tell me that, okay, I follow Instagram for news. No, there are places where you can follow news. Go to a newspaper's app, download a newspaper app and read that. You cannot get information from Instagram unless you're following a news channel's account. Just because a personality or a celebrity or somebody puts up some news updates, you are reading that and you're feeling that, okay, I'm updated. I follow this guy's account or this girl's account and I get all information. No, they're just mouthpieces. Whatever information they get, they pass it on. But if you are a literate, if you know English, if you know your language, whichever it is, English, Malayalam, or whatever your tongue, mother tongue is, and if there is a newspaper available, or if there is a news app that is available, or if there is articles that come out, please go read that, because you are not in a position where you, you know, malus or, you know, multitask within one social media. And sometimes social media has to be kept aside for fun. Meanwhile, you know, you have to also make sure that you are up to date with information. So this is something that I reiterate to people, right? Social media is for me more of connection and networking. It is not a place where you gain information. Obviously, these days, because of the amount of information that is dispersed on social media, for me also, it becomes the mouth or the channel where I gain something. Okay, I get to know that, okay, something has happened, or China's rocket is going to fall off. How do I know this? Because somebody posted it on social media. But that does not mean that I find that information on social media. I then go out of my social media platform, I go to a normal, you know, browser, and I search for that, and then I start reading about it. Let's say tomorrow the Mars mission is happening. I do not sit on social media and read about it. I go out of that social media, I go to a platform where, you know, there is authentic NASA news, and then I read that. So this habit has to become very ardent eventually. It doesn't happen over a day, but it also increases on how you find information. You do this every day, it hardly takes you less than a minute to type something on Google and click that go button. But in meantime, if you use social media wisely, you can increase your connections, you can increase your networking, and also meanwhile, get information from them on how they maintain their knowledge database, right? Why would I want to get connected to somebody on LinkedIn? Because I look forward to that person for something, either a work opportunity or gain information from them or just get inspired. So whatever my reason is, I have to also study from what they do. So, like I said before, in the digital era, there is two things. One is data and one is network. Network, like all the logos that you see on my screen, I'm sure you have access to all of this. Even data, whatever logos I've put, you've pretty much used most of it. But it is very important to differentiate data and network. You use network, at sometimes it might get, you know, interconvened of how you consume data and network, but it is very, you know, mandatory or very much necessity that you guys have to be very keen about what you consume as data and what you consume for network. Let's say if you have a mobile screen time of 10 hours, right, considering that all of us are doing social distancing and staying home and, you know, isolating ourselves, you might spend, say, easily, how much? Like, you might easily spend around 10 hours on social media, and that's okay. I'm not saying that's bad. But in that 10 hours, you have to make sure that how much do you contribute to gaining information? How many articles have you read? And when I say reading, it doesn't mean you have to read something which is, say, 500 words or which is 1,000 words. I'm telling you to read something which is a 2-minute read or a 5-minute read. But there has to be some form of information gathered. Like, you have to make sure that the amount of consumption of data that you do is more than all the scrolling that you do and, you know, things like that. And it's totally fine if your screen time is more or whatever, because in the current world, that is how the world, like, you know, the change in the whole ecosystem is happening. Now, it's also, now that you have access, and I spoke about how the amount of access that you have, it's also important about getting ready for it, right? It is all about you, and you have to go find opportunities. Like, I see a lot of people put up posts on LinkedIn saying that I've passed out of college, I'm looking for jobs, please share my post. if you just tell me that I've got out of college and I'm looking for a job, I'm not sitting here to give you a job, right? You have to make sure that you're skill ready, that there has to be something that you tell me that you're good at. You can't, and also you can't say you can't say qualitative skills, right? You can't say I sing, I dance, I write, I read. These are not skills, right? These are something everybody does. I speak. These are not things. You have to be more accurate about the quantitative skill set that you own. Like you should be able to say that I can write blogs of 500 to 1,000 words on topics, or I can take sessions for, you know, underprivileged students. You know, you should be able to define what you're capable of. I'm just giving you examples that you can relate. But even in terms of engineering, you should be able to say what your focus area is. You should be able to say that this is what excites me and this is what I want to work on. And even if you say this is what I want to work on, you should have enough background to state that, okay, this is how I want to look it. So that's where the whole process of a resume or a portfolio comes into place, right? And what happens in most engineering colleges, unfortunately, is we are told to make a resume, you know, when? Maybe end of third year or beginning of fourth year, and placement drive happens. Until then, we have no clue how a resume looks like. I mean, obviously, all of us know what a resume is and all, but we never make one. So that's the reason why I say that it is not a process of blame, but it's also a process of us finding out what we want to do. I suggest people to have a resume from the time you pass out of a school, right? Like you should have a portfolio, or you should have like a CV of yours, of the accomplishments that you have done, of the things that you have learned, of the projects that you have done, right? And that has to keep getting reiterated every time you move on. So in the first year, your resume will look different to what it'll look in your third year and what it'll look in your fourth year, right? But it's very important that you have a resume. And when you make a resume, you know, just don't copy paste thing from Google and write. Like most resumes I see, they are like, you know, like just copy paste it. Like it'll be like, even the words of what do you want to do sounds same. Like everybody says, there's this usual sentence, I'm a highly skilled professional looking for opportunities in a growing atmosphere. I'm like, everybody knows this. Even I know it today. I'm just like, 4 years out of college, and I myself can see a resume and say how much of time was put into that resume. So it is important that you write in your first word, right? Like you write what you feel. It's okay if you don't hypervent information into it or use jargons or big English words. Just, you know, use it as your authentic self. Write about your achievements. And another way I feel is a good use of a resume is, say, imagine if I had a resume when I was in my 12th grade, I would know, okay, these are the things that is in my resume. And it doesn't look great. Like as a school student, I haven't accomplished many things. Or maybe in first year, I did 2 events, or maybe I conducted an IEEE event, or I participated in a best manager competition and I won it, or whatever, right? So when I write that, it also helps me understand where am I progressing. So every time I look at my resume, I know, okay, this is what I need to add on. Okay, this course I can do so that I can add it to my resume. So it will help you gain a competitive edge. And in the process, it will help you improve yourself. So, these are like basic things that I always try to focus when I talk to people about resume, when they ask me about, how does your resume look different? So I never make resumes with basic templates. Okay, my resume is made from a Google slide. Obviously, I can't show it to you guys here, but if you go to my website, you can see that I've uploaded it there. So, you know, I just used Google slides and I just made a resume that I feel confident about. So I write about the technologies that I know. I write about my managerial skills, because these days you can't just say I'm an engineer. That's not enough. People management skills, being able to speak, being able to lead a team, being able to manage a project are all like by default things that you must know. And how do you know this? By doing events in your college, or by arranging projects, or by working together for a nonprofit organization. So, you know, it's important that you focus on technology, which is what are your skills? What is the technology that you know? Okay, you know social media well, write that. You know how to make a website, write that. Managerial skills, write about about the things that you have accomplished. When I mean research, it is about what is the topic that excites you. Like for me, okay, I'm interested in 3D printing, or I'm interested to know more about EV vehicles. So, you know, like write about that aspect of yours which is curious about research. It doesn't mean that you have to go do a PhD. The reason why I've used that word is to tell you that that is how a future looks to that. You are interested in something. I'm always interested about that. So that becomes your research aspect of your resume. Write about training as in your education, not just your plus two degree or your engineering degree that you're pursuing. Write about other things, the courses that you have done. There are so many free courses. I'm not saying that you have to pay something and then do a course. There are enormous number of courses available, even within IEEE. Today, because we are talking as a part of an IEEE event, I want to focus that if you go to the IEEE website, there's so much there on that website that, you know, so much of information, so much of training programs that you can always use. And then the last thing is volunteering. It is very important that you volunteer. Whatever be the, you know, cause of it, you have to volunteer in one or the other form. It can be NSS, it can be, you know, some COVID relief group, it can be a flood related management, it can be a disaster management project, or it can be just doing a survey, understanding what are the different kind of sports people watch now that they're in isolation. Whatever that is, right? Volunteer yourself to form a group and do something that in return helps something else. So that's when you volunteer, right? Where you do not expect a payout of it. And just as I kept speaking, I have definitely pretty much covered all of this about, you know, what are the do's and don'ts that have to be, you know, in a resume. And moving forward, what I want to tell is more than a resume, if you have a proper LinkedIn account where everything is updated, all your data, all your achievements, and LinkedIn pretty much has features for all of that. You put an about section about you, you write about your accomplishments, your scores, your areas of interest. Then what more do you need? You're building a public persona there. You have to get to a point where tomorrow somebody tells you, like say your father's friend tells me that, okay, please send your resume to me. You should be able to send your LinkedIn URL and tell that person, sir, everything is available on this portal. So that is where you have to get to, because you as a personal brand explains who you are, what you do, and why you are better than anyone else, right? And when I say better than anyone else, doesn't mean that, okay, somebody has an 8 CGPA, another person has a 6 CGPA, the 8th person is better. The better can be in multiple forms, just like I mentioned. So, and the reason of why I'm saying all of this, right? You guys will be like, oh, I have placements, I have good scores, I might just track it that way. But the reason why I'm saying this is, for some, it might work. For some, it might not work. But once you enter the professional world, right, that's when you actually start feeling the shackle. This is like how you see on social media, right? Like when you're in 10th grade, your parents will tell you, please focus. This is the most important exam of your life. And after this, your life is sorted. And then in 12th, they tell this to you again. Once you do engineering, they tell this to you. Then they tell you to do masters. Once you get into a job, you have to somehow perform better for a promotion. So this life keeps going. And also the reason why it is very important to focus on this is because our current education system was designed in the pre-internet era, and we are living in the post-internet era and in an industrial revolution where we are transitioning from the third industrial revolution to an industry 4.0 where 3D manufacturing, AI, robotics, nanotechnology, like all of this is happening, right? So if you look at your textbook, I can give you an example. I always take this example. Your engineering physics textbooks were written by my physics teacher whose name is Premlit. He wrote that book, I think, almost 20 years before I studied. Okay. So then I studied it. Now you are studying it. Another 10 more years, people will study that. In that textbook, if you really ask me, the content hasn't changed much over all these years. Not that, that is just an example, but you take any of your engineering textbooks, the content that we study or our current education system is from Charlie Chaplin's time. So it is very important that you don't only rely on that. Obviously, we can't change the system. We cannot change the system tomorrow, right? And we have become a part of it. So, you know, again, we are not here to blame. But, you know, we are here to focus so that we can, bridge that gap and get past it. So what I felt was, we do study that, not like there isn't much in it, but what I started doing at least by third year, right? Because until then, nobody really told me anything. I used to never go to college most of the days. I used to bunk my classes and I did mechanical engineering. So it is not a very strict, hard and fast, in you know, branch in any college for that matter of fact. So, you know, what I started feeling was whatever excited me, right? Like whenever I went to college or whenever I was studying for an exam, if there was a topic that excited me, what I will do is I will take my smartphone and I will search more about it. Just Google search. And then I'll keep scrolling, reading like one paragraph. Then I'll scroll, I'll read something else, one paragraph. But in that process, I was gaining a lot of extra information. And what is the most important, irrespective of pandemic, obviously the pandemic giving more stress to it, is that you should have a global mindset. You cannot say that, okay, I'm in a college in Wayanad, or I'm in a college in, say, Kollam, and or I'm in a college studying in Kerala, this is how much I need to know. No, there is nothing like that. The mindset has to go on a horizon from where you are to where you aspire to become. Because what social conditioning does to us is exactly what happens to us in schools, right? We go to a particular school, a particular set of people come there to study, you see only a particular type of mindset. But imagine what happened when you move to engineering colleges. There is a shift in change. You get to see more people coming from diverse backgrounds. You get to see more people coming from different family orientations. So just like that, even your mindset in terms of education, profession, vocation has to become global. So these are four things that I keep telling people. That is, one, you have to start early. When I say start early, start things from first year, right? I really feel bad of the fact that I was not told a lot of things. I was told in my third year, in my first year. Because if you would have told me that in my first year, I would have prepped myself because I had enough time. Once you reach third year, you have your project, you have your seminar, God knows what all. And then along with that, people push you hard to get better. Second thing is cultivate curiosity. Like I said, you don't have to like all the subjects that you study, but it's important that whatever you like, you cultivate curiosity on it. You know, it's mere curiosity that helps us learning. Our capacity to learn also increase only if you have curiosity. Otherwise, you know, anything is boring. Why do we binge watch a Netflix series? That's because there's curiosity building across episodes, right? Like, you know, you finish one and you're like, oh my God, what happens next? Similarly, even any form of learning or any form of information intake has to have some form of curiosity. Hence, it is very important to understand what you like, because the reason why you binge watch a Netflix show is because you like it. So in terms of studies or in terms of a particular subject of matter is also that you have to understand what your focus is on. Third one is be very intentional. Like I said, this is not a blame game. I see a lot of younger generation pushing it hard on our systems, on how our colleges are, or, you know, the lack of access to things. So here, the only process is being intentional. You have to push yourself. You have an internet pack in your phone. You have a smartphone. You have Google search all at your disposal. It's up to you to be intentional and figure out what you want to know more. And if you know something, tell it to your friends, tell it to your roommates, tell it to the people in your house. Nothing is going to harm you. You read about a Mars mission, tell it to your parents, right? They might not be people interested in the Mars mission, but tell them that, okay, this is what's happening today. So-and-so thing is happening. NASA is sending so-and-so thing in, and it can carry so much weight. It has used origami for, you know, placing one of the helicopters inside so that it can reduce space. And once it lands, it opens up. You know, these are things that will excite everybody. So if you have access to it, then attain that and give it to others as well. And fourth one is celebrate diversity. The reason why I say this is, you might meet different kind of people and they might have different sorts of emotions, different sorts of backgrounds, different sorts of ways of how they study. Now you have to celebrate it. Only if you celebrate it is when you will be able to understand how they go through that process, and that will help you as well. And also, once you pass out as an engineering graduate, right, irrespective of where you work, as an engineer, as a film director, or as a singer, whatever your workplace is, in today's world, the workplace is constantly evolving, right? What it was 5 years back and what it is today is different. What it was last year and what it is today is different. So it is constantly evolving, and hence us adapting to these fast-paced changes is also important. So your college might not equip you to do a website. Your college might not have taught you to, you know, use a PowerPoint efficiently or be a, you know, smart ass when it comes to handling Excel sheets. But you have to adapt to these fast changes and, you know, get used to that nature of work. You can't go for work and say, oh, I'm not good. I'm not that good at Excel sheet. I just know addition, calculation, making tabular columns. But, you know, I can't put all these if else or, you know, formulas like that. But the thing is, you should have prepared yourself in that meantime. And encouraging tech savviness, like, it's very important that you are very tech savvy. You can't say that, okay, I'm not a very social media person, or I don't use a lot of apps. I don't listen to podcasts. It is boring for me. You have to be tech savvy in one or the other way. So you have to find your means of what you like. And if you have a mobile phone, which is a smartphone, make sure if you have 100 apps that you use, at least 20 of those 100 apps are apps that make sense to you, that helps you gain better and helps you, you know, get information. And I tell this not quite often, because most of us tend to be in our own comfort zones. And with everything that's happening around in this world, I feel it's very important for us to get comfortable with that. I know isolation or online classes or in general, the things happening around us might be a little too much to handle. But whatever the situation is, I feel the more we intentionally try to keep ourselves cheerful, the more we intentionally try to be comfortable in this whole mess that we are part of, it just gets better. And you have to always keep looking beyond. Like I said, if this is what is expected out of your college, then look one step above. If this is what your placement guidelines tell you, look one step above. You have to keep looking beyond and above. Otherwise, you know, you're just anybody else. And there are almost 1.3 million people who pass out as engineers in India every year. So if you want to even stand out in the top 10% or 20% or even 50%, it's a lot of work. And that work has to come from you. And continuously learning is a very much prerequisite. You learn things in college. Meanwhile, you learn additional skills. Go for courses. And it can be anything, right? If you're interested in calligraphy, do that. If you're interested in art, do that. If you're interested in something else, do that. It necessarily needn't be a particular, you know, educational matter. It can be anything that makes you curious, right? And the reason why I say continual learning is important is because all of us human beings and all of the animals around us, we have a by birth quality to acquire, fine tune and transfer knowledge throughout our lifespan. Unless and until you have any mental condition, any psychological disorder, you have this ability by default in you. So nobody can say that she's smarter than me. No, she's not smarter than you. Her societal conditions, her exposure to information and how her sensory skills were developed is better than yours. That's all. So it has to do a lot with parenting, social context, our exposure to things. But meanwhile, you have to understand that all of us, irrespective, if not, you don't have any mental condition, we are by default able to do this. Now, I'm sure you would have heard a lot of people tell you that the more you grow older, you tend to decrease the ability to learn, right? You know why this happens is because you stop learning. It's simple as that. If you continuously keep learning something or the other, then that doesn't really decrease. I know somebody who's turning 100 years old today, who's an active IEEE member, and he still is studying something. So, you know, what I have realized when people kept telling me this, that's when I even went out there on internet. I tried reading about lifelong learning. I understood what continual learning is, how the neural system works. I haven't put all the information here, but if you are interested, definitely go read it. There's a lot of study on how our neural system works and why continual learning is important to keep that intact, right? And one thing I want to tell you is the personal learning cloud, right? Nowadays, you don't have to depend on a college or you don't have to depend on anything to learn something. Learning is very much personalized. You want to learn something, you just type it on Google. There's n number of YouTube videos. There's a lot of platforms like Coursera, edX, and Byju's, and Entry. And there's so many platforms where you can learn. Forget everything. You can just go to LinkedIn Learning and you can learn. So learning has become very personalized. Whatever you choose, you can learn. Learning has become very socialized. Every time you learn something, you join a course, you also get a community of course students. And learning has become very contextualized also. Like if I like 3D, I can only learn 3D. I don't have to go loiter around learning other things. But in school, it wasn't like that, right? Even if you like social science, you have have to like still learn it. Maybe you are more interested in science, but you have no option but learn social science, right? So eventually the world is evolving into a more personal learning cloud format where a lot of massive open online courses are open. And now it's up to you to understand what your learning outcomes are. You can track yourself, you can check whether it's helping you, and that is also a way of how you get better at it. Going forward to diversity in engineering, this is definitely one diversity, obviously, which is needed. Like I said, we meet different people of different contexts. They come from different places. Their thought processes are different. So trying to understand that is important. So just like I said, diversity of people, of practices, equity in terms of understanding the policy, practice and position, right? Like a lot of people ask me that when I do webinars, why doesn't our education system change if there's so much of backdated information in it? But like I say, it doesn't change in a day. Obviously, there are efforts being taken to reach out to universities or reach out to the education sector and tell them that we definitely need a change in what is written. But at the same time, there has to be a lot of inclusion. Like there has to be a lot of, when I say inclusion, I don't know how you look at these words, but the way I look at these words is more of a community-driven words, right? It helps you listen to a lot of people. Like somebody who studied in a school in Idiki would have a different exposure to somebody who had studied in a school in Kochi, or somebody who had studied in a school in Pune because his father was in the army. So it is important to listen to all of them and then take a unified approach to it. Most of the times we are not very inclusive to how we think. We always bucket ourselves. When people talk about feminism, it's just people in one group. When people talk about toxic masculinity, it's just people from one group. Sometimes it's important that we listen to all the voices, become very inclusive, and then go towards like a, you know, more definable approach. When we, or let's say when I or you, I don't know how many of you knew, what to choose in engineering when you had the option to write your engineering exam, right? In my case, I was fortunate enough. My mother was very clear to explain to me what are the different courses available in engineering and how it should be approached. So just like she said and what I found on the internet, there are the big fours in engineering, which is mechanical, civil, electrical, and chemical. Everything else comes in one or the other way as a by-branch to this. So I remember somebody, a friend of my mom's, telling me that, you know, it's important that when we do our undergraduation, which is, you know, our graduation degree or the course that we do right after college, I mean, right after school, it has to be a mainstream subject. Like if I do aeronautical engineering or geonatal engineering or let's say, you know, biomedical engineering, that is a very core sector. Now, what that does is once you take such an engineering course, obviously there is IT also in it. But then pretty much, you know, IT evolved from an electrical and electronics perspective, because initially, if you look back, not all engineering colleges in Kerala had IT or computer science. So what I felt was, in a way, once we derive, like once we do a core subject, right, then you are stuck in that. You do, let's say, any of this. Even say computer science for that matter of fact, then you can only pursue a degree or pursue a work associated to that. But if you choose any engineering degree that falls into one of these four, it opens your sector to a lot more of things. Now, all of these that you're seeing, right, like say from sports engineering to aerospace engineering to nano engineering to food engineering, these are all like different segments of how engineering has evolved. And in this part, what happens is you have a lot more option to look into. And it is totally fine that if you do not have a lot more option as well, because even if you do any kind of engineering, there are engineering management opportunities that you have. You can become a project manager, you can become a technology manager, you can become an engineering manager. So if you are somebody who wants more of a people managerial role, more of an MBA, like you see a lot of people do BTech plus MBA, right? But there's other options also, not necessary that you follow that trend and go do an MBA. You can do an engineering management degree. You still become a manager there. You still become a engineering or technology manager there. So what I want to tell you is read more about these things. See what excites you. See what exactly what do you want to do. If you are a computer science person, do you want to sit and code all your life? Or do you want to manage a product? Or do you want to build something? So this has to pretty much derive on how you think, is what I feel. So according to me, engineering isn't a mere degree. It is a study to create, operate, maintain, and further innovate. So irrespective of what engineering you have done, though these are all things which will really help us to gauge what exactly we want to do before engineering, after engineering, I feel like this course helps you or prepares you to face that design thinking methodology, right? You write so many exams in 4 years, you do projects, you meet so many people, you are part of so many organizations. I feel it's just preparing you to be better. Like today, any industry that you take has a lot of engineering graduates in it, though they are not working in the sector that they were meant for. So exactly why engineering is in a way is because it helps you empathize, define problems, it helps you become innovative. When I say prototype, it doesn't really mean building a car prototype. It means about prototyping about what a new project idea can look like. How can you do a new community service? How can you act upon a condition that is happening? So, you know, in a way, this is the routine process of how it keeps going. So engineering has never been so powerful because it helps you dissolve complex societal problems as well, right? Like in IEEE also, it says advancing for human, you know, human, like humanitarian activities or things like that. Let's say there's a pandemic or there's a flood. I'm taking our own, you know, examples around us so that you can relate. Whenever such problems happen, it's engineers who go out there, irrespective of what their work is. You will see a lot of these people getting that, you know, power to do things because they have got used to bigger problems. And going more focus into women in engineering, I'm sure all of you know about feminism. There's so much of noise around it on social media. With all of that, what I truly believe is the exact meaning of what feminism is, which is it's the advocacy of women's right on the ground of equality for sexes. We are clearly a worthy opposite of a man. There is no comparison of what he can do or what you can do, but you are definitely asking for an opportunity. Most times women in India, or say most part of the world, India is just like a subsidial place because of the high population, you feel it's more here. The more I started having exposure with people from Japan, with people from the Western world, I realized that this problem exists across the globe. Just that how they get past it and how we get past it is a little, you know, dependent on the time that we take. So for me, a few people that I really follow when it comes to women leadership, one is definitely Sudha Murthy. And I love this quote that she said, which is, if you try to please everyone, you will please no one. Because in the whole process of doing that, you stop focusing on yourself. And it is very important to figure out what you want to do. And also, this is one thing, right? The biggest barrier for any woman is the thought that they can't have it all. Most of the time, you're a woman, or, you know, women in engineering is a different thing. And so many other things in the name of advocacy and obviously with good intentions happen, but it also somewhere hinders us to become our own biggest barriers in terms of doing things. And you know, just to give you an insight about numbers, if you look from 1901 to 2011, there are 802 individuals from 20 organizations who have got Nobel Prize, right? The Nobel laureates. Now out of that, 43 are women, only 43. Now that's 5%. And when I was reading about this, I figured out that most of it is because their work is not cited out. Like women doing work or professional things are not much being told about outside, right? If you go on social media, why does somebody follow a woman? Because her pictures are nice, because she writes good poems. When will people start following a woman for the kind of work she does or the kind of articles she writes about science? So it's high time we change that perspective. Lastly, before we close, I'll quickly take you through certain very personal learning phases or journey that I've had. I don't read. So when I say I don't read Harry Potter, I don't read Twilight, I don't even read Chetan Bhagat stories. So when I say I don't read, like my parents, my teachers, my schoolmates, my college mates, everybody used to look upon me as saying, oh, she doesn't read. Now, when I say I don't read, it clearly means I don't read these books, or I don't read, you know, fictional stories, or I don't read things to increase my English vocabulary in a way. But I read so much information on the internet. I follow so many blogs by very famous personalities from all across the world who write about technology, who write about healthcare, who write about psychology, who write about managerial skills, who write about technology management. Now, in a way, that is reading for me, right? And I love listening to podcasts. So my form of gaining information might not be what the other 10 people are doing, but it is important that you have a form of information. And when I say I like visualizing, it's because I like watching documentaries. Like, I remember information more when I watch it somewhere or when I watch it as a video. So like, if you ask me the history of Britain, I would know it completely because I watched a Netflix show, but I would not have remembered it if I would have read the whole of that story in a textbook, right? So it is also important for you to identify what is the channel by which you want to gain information. And this is an activity I do in every session, is that I just want to make you guys understand the power of each of your brains, though you guys are sitting on a different part of this place in front of another laptop. When I show you a red spot on my screen and I tell that this is red color, what comes to your head are multiple other red things that you have seen in your life. Definitely, it's not coming from Moon or Mars because you have not gone there, but these are all things that you have seen in your life. And in a split second, when I say red, everything red that you have seen in your life would have somehow gone across your head. Now, for each of us, it will be different. For each of us, you know, it might be varying from what we do, right? Say, for me, what I showed today might be the things that's close to my head. Or, you know, okay, I watched a Manchester United match yesterday, so that's in my head. I'm on my period, so okay, menstrual bread is on my head. I saw roses in one of the Instagram posts I was scrolling today, so I saw that. So, you know, it clearly depends on our memory, but in a split second time, so many things, right? Even logos of brands like Vodafone or Zomato. I'm like, these are all things that you see. And it really helps. Just because it is a red circle doesn't mean you only think of Bindi, right? So this is how powerful your brain is. And it's also important to embrace your choice of work, right? You can be the person on the left and you can also be the person on the right. For me, I'm more of a person on the right. I like things organized. It all started in the way I keep my table and desk, right? So I put across my things well, and, you know, I always make sure that everything in my house is tidy and neat, and I have kept things in an orderly manner. I like it to be stacked or put across in a particular way. So I used to always enjoy that. And then I thought, maybe why not, you know, start looking at my work also that way. So that's when I discovered that this organizational hiccup that I have of putting things in place should be used to get along with something that I really want to do, or I really want to focus on, right? And that's when I started focusing on things that will make my work smart work. Now, when I say smart work, I'm a very lazy person. And I'm sure out of the N number of people who are listening to me now, a lot of you might be lazy like me. And it's totally okay. Being lazy does not make you less efficient. I feel being lazy makes you more efficient, because you can't use laziness as an excuse. You can't use procrastination as an excuse. So you end up doing things that in a hurry, and somehow you finish things. It's just that you work smarter. And to give you more insights about that, you know, my smart work hacks, as I call it, these are the 10 things that are like a must for me, right? Like I said, you should definitely have a LinkedIn account. Your LinkedIn account should solve all your problems of having a resume, a profile, a portfolio, whatever you want, right? Like a proper biography for you. Second thing is Gmail. Like, I don't know how many of you use it, but I'm sure all of you should have a Gmail account or whatever. Like, it can be Yahoo, Outlook, whatever your choice of an email system is. And please read all your emails and try to you know, look at it, like, you know, read every email and see what the information is. Mark your emails, make buckets of where each email goes, you know, things like that. I'm soon going to write about in detail about these on my blog sometime this week or next week. And if you guys are interested, you can go read that as well. But I feel, you know, opening your Gmail and reading every email is important, especially because you're an IEEE member. Because when I was in my second year, I was going for an event, and I think it was some link event or something. And then I met one of our senior IEEE members. His name is Renjit, and I'm sure you guys would have also met him or heard about him somewhere. He's a YP today. So I asked him, like, you've gone to so many countries for IEEE events. Like, I think he's easily gone to some 20 odd countries just for IEEE events. So I was like, Renjitata, how do you do this? Like, you know, it's so fascinating to see you just do this out of your engineering degree and go to so many countries. So the answer he gave me was, I shall read all the emails that IEEE sends you. From that day till today, there's not even one IEEE email I have not read. And not just IEEE email, there's not even one email that I have not read at all. So even if it's a promotional email, I will open, I will read it. And if it's not something that excites me, what I do is I just go to the unsubscribe button and I press it so that I do not get emails from them. And there's not even one unread email in my box when I sleep that night. So I've made it a practice, and that's like a very godly practice that I do. I worship my Gmail box because that has everything that I want. And I subscribe to the right kind of information that I want so that I get emails, I read those things. So it's very important on how you maintain your Gmail box. I call it the Gmail God. And that really will help you level up your game a little bit. The third logo that you're seeing is the Google Calendar. So whatever you do, right, I tell people that just have a calendar, like just, you know, follow a calendar and, you know, put everything in it. Say today you have a session. This has to be in your calendar. After this session, you have told your sister that I help you with something that you want to do. Mark that on your calendar. Like, you know, it has to be a form where your calendar is like filled. You need to know. When I'm not saying you have to put your sleep on your calendar, but all the important things that you want to do, it's very important that you put these things on your calendar. And in a way, it is also important that it really helps you to understand the amount of time that you put across in doing something important, in doing finishing some work. Or, you know, however you want to assign it. You've told your father you'll help him with something. You've told your brother you'll do something. You were supposed to go to a particular online site and order something. Whatever it is, try filling your Google Calendar. And for all of this, you don't even need a laptop today. You have a Google Calendar app on your phone. You can even do it on the phone, and the phone will remind you. You don't even have to have reminder apps anymore. The Google Calendar will remind you about it. So that is my... That's a very important third thing. The fourth thing is a to-do list, right? Now, when I say a to-do list, I don't know how many of you subscribe to the fact of having a to-do list, but it is very important, I felt, because we can't remember everything in our head, right? We do so many things in 24 hours that at some point, you know, we really need additional help to remember a lot of things. So what I do in my life, this is a very personal information that I am giving. I tested it, I tried it, and I felt really good about it, is that anything that I want to do, I have a notepad, which is what I call my to-do list, or I have sticky notes that I put up on the wall or on my desk or wherever I sit. And what I do is I just put a hyphen and I write whatever I want to do. So let's say I have this webinar that I have told that I want to attend, I'm speaking at, so I write, okay, there's a webinar on so-and-so day, I need to make a PPT. Then below that, I will write, okay, I need to send my headshot and my bio to the organizer. Okay, that's written. And when I was doing this, my mom is like, okay, can you order this home? So I'll be like, okay, have to order, say, coconut sugar to my house. At that same time, my friend is like, hey, can you please cross-check my application for my MBA admission? So I'll be like, okay, cross-check this. So whatever, right, be it the smallest or the silliest thing. Say, for example, now I told you, draw an ikigai chart. If you have a book like that, or you can do this to-do list on your phone as well. So you just write it, okay, ikigai chart. Now,
when you want to do it, you don't have to write it. I'm not saying you have to be that structured. Now, that's up to you. You can put it a deadline. But for me, I feel when I write this, and every time I finish something, I go across it. Now, I keep writing so much that some days I have like 3 pages of things to do and I haven't done, and I'll be still on my bed. And that's totally okay. But I know that I have those 3 pages of things to do. But if you do not write it and you lie on the bed, you will eventually start dropping out the things that is in your head, right? So according to me, that to-do list is very important. The fifth logo that you see is the logo of an app called Mobils, M-O-B-I-L-L-S. Now, the reason why I suggest people to have an application like Mobils on your phone is because it is very important to know financially where do you place yourself. So let's say, even if I was in college, right? For me, it was always very important to understand how much do I spend on myself every month. So this happened because I did a financial some webinar when I was in third year of college, and they were telling about how to save money and all of that. So I was like, even when I was in my college, I would write down. Back then I did not have a phone with that app, but then I used to write down saying that, okay, my mess bill was this much, or I bought a gift for my friend for this much. I paid so much for my exam fees. Though my complete expenses used to come from my parents, I still wrote this down. And by the end of the month, I know how much did I spend. Or even if you're at home, right? If you can ask your mother or your father or your guardian, how much do we spend on grocery? So let's say they say, 5,000 rupees for a month. So that means, and if you are one out of the 5 members of the house, then you contribute almost 1,000 rupees to what your grocery is. So I feel it's very important for you to track the expense that you incur in a month. And this has to be done on a regular basis. You give 10 rupees to a beggar, right? That as well, because it's not going to harm you writing that somewhere. And when there is an app, you can always check out other apps as well. I'm sure there's so many other apps available on the internet, but I felt this is good because I've tried and tested out so many apps, and this is what's most comfortable for me. So, and this is free. So it's important that you maintain something like this. And once, even when you start earning, right? And even in third year, fourth year, you can still do content writing jobs. You can do small paid jobs here and there and make money. You can do art and crafts, sell it and make money. You can paint, you can sell that and make money. So, you will inculcate that habit of working, which is very uncommon in our culture. I know a lot of my friends who are from US or UK, and the best part of what they do is that, their parents force them to do some job once they are 18, right? Because the work age there is 18. As soon as they're 18, they're sent to some part-time job. Some go to clean cars, some go to pick ice, some work in a bakery. So in one or the other way, irrespective of whether they're rich, poor, privileged, or whatever, that sense of doing a job and earning the money is very much important. Like, this is just like how when we were like really small kids, we used to get pocket money, right? And I used to plan so much with that pocket money. I'll decide what are the things I want to buy. I'll decide what all I'll do with that pocket money. Even if it was 100 rupees, there was so much of things to be decided on it. So similarly, it is very important that you track this, and I urge all of you to do it. If you want to do it on a paper, do it on a paper. If you want to do it on an Excel sheet, do it on an Excel sheet. But make sure that, say, from one financial year, and I'm sure all of you know that one financial year starts from 1st of April and it goes till the 31st of March. So, calculate that financial year. Do it for one financial year and see how your expenses are. And you should eventually start learning. Obviously, I'm not going to use this webinar for that. But it's also very important to, understand your savings. How do you save? What do you want to save for? What are the things that you want to buy in your life? Is a Ray-Ban glass more important than buying a scooter? Or is buying a car your first dream and you will start saving for it? So, planning your finances is very important. And this is where most women are a step behind, I must say. And not intentionally, but by default, it happens because of this whole loop of marriage that falls into place. So it's usually understood that, okay, you finish your degree, you get a job. Once you become earning, then you get married, and then you don't know what will happen. Because after that word, people don't know what is going to happen. So, but then as you prepare growing up as a woman, this is what's told you, right? And you'll be like, okay, after marriage, what happens? They'll be like, that depends on who you get married to. So then it's indefinite. But until then, people keep telling you this, and hence your focus on financially becoming independent is somewhere redundant, and I feel it's very important that you focus on this. If you go to the bottom of what I have written, now I will not tell everybody to follow it very ardently, but the first thing is to have a website. So let's say your name is Akshaya Shetty. You should just buy a domain, www.akshayashetty.com, right? Because it's your name and it's very unique. You will get the domain for like 500 rupees or 600 rupees. Sometimes you might even get it for 50 rupees. So you have to buy that domain. Now, I'm not saying that you have to publish the domain and send it to the world and tell everybody that you have a website, but use website making tools like WordPress or Wix or things like that, which is free, which is easy to make. You don't need to code, and make a profile for yourself. Put all your work on it. You click good photographs of the sky, put that. Make a gallery and put that. You write about things, put that. Anything that you do, you did a project, put that. You taught somebody to make an art and craft, put that. So having a website is really like a self-motivator. And once you have a website, it also becomes your personal brand. So for me, I feel it's very important that all of us have one. And it's up to us on what we want to put there. Nobody else needs to choose that for you. You make a website, and it also helps you understand on how to lay out things, right? Your design sensibility itself increases when you do a drag and drop website and make a layout of your own. It will resonate the color that you want to show. It will resonate how you want to represent yourself. The second thing that you see on the second line is obviously having a blog or writing. Not necessary that your blog has to be for people to read it. You can always have a private blog as well. And when I say blog, you don't have to use words like Shashi Tharoor, or you don't have to write about the COVID pandemic or how the vaccine is getting better. You can write about anything, right? Whatever you feel like. I started my habit of writing, obviously, very, very long back. I have a history to why I write. But then, you know, as an IEEE member, what I did was every time I attended an event, and I'm sure you guys would attend 100 odd IEEE events in a year, I started writing about that event, and in my own words, not like a report or like a, you know, official format. I just write, okay, this today's speaker was this. Sometimes it used to be bullet points and I'm like super lazy, but I used to just do it. I used to just write how that event was. What are the 10 things, like right after I finish this webinar, right? Just take a pen paper and just write 10 bullet points of what you remember from this 1 hour that we had a conversation about. Just write words. Okay, you remember LinkedIn, you remember NASA, you remember sports, you remember mobiles app, whatever you remember from this whole conversation that we had, just note that down. And you know, you will eventually cultivate that habit of writing. Writing is as important as reading. And the next one is the streak. I don't know how many of you know, streak is about following a streak, right? Like how you say 21 days is required to form a habit. Similarly, you need to do things in a streak. Say I decide that every day evening, I'm doing that. I decide every day evening that I will click a picture of the sky and I'll put it on Instagram as my sky, that day's sky. So I have to keep following my streak. I did it today, I have to do it tomorrow. No matter what happens, no matter the world goes upside down, I have to follow that streak. So in the world, there's this process of following a 100-day streak, 200-day streak. So it can be small things. You decide that you will, you will arrange your bed. When you wake up in the morning, your bed is all messy. So you decide that from tomorrow onwards, first thing I will do after I wake up is like fold my bed sheet and keep my bed clean. Now do this for 100 days, right? Follow that streak. Don't leave it one day just because you're lazy. Because if you keep pushing yourself, then your streak will become better. So I figured out this from an app called Duolingo where I study French, where, you know, you have to follow a streak. Let's say after 5 days, the sixth day, if I don't go to the app and do a 15-minute session, they just cut all my 6 days of streak and I have to start a new streak. So, you know, it just pushes you to flow with how it has to go. And the last two, definitely the last one is reading. I don't have to reiterate on that. Read whatever you feel like reading. You don't have to read storybooks or novels or big biographies. Read small articles. Read things which are 1 minute, 2 minute, 3 minute, because our attention span is not great. Trust me, with all the social media doom scrolling and things that we have done, our brain is now more attracted to short form content. So read things that are 2 minute reads, 3 minute reads, or max say 10 minute reads, because after a point you will not be able to sustain that much information unless you write about it. So reading is definitely there. Right before reading, if you see, there is one thing that I have clearly focused on, and that slide in my thing says, I'm not a procrastinator, But I'm a very deadline-oriented person. So, for example, I know I have to make a PPT for today's session. So, the organizers of the event reached out to me like a few days back. But that doesn't mean that I will sit and make the PPT that day. If my talk is at 4 o'clock today, I have blocked in my calendar 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock today, 1 hour, or 2 o'clock to 2:30 today, 30 minutes to make the PPT. Now, that is the extra deadline that I put to myself. So, I know. Now, what happens from 2 to 2:30 is I can't be lazy at that time. I can be lazy all through the week not doing this. But the 2 to 2:30, I will hit myself hard because at 4, I have to meet you guys. At 4, I should have a PPT to talk to you guys. So, for me, I felt a deadline-driven concept works better for me because that kind of really pushes me to work faster, work smarter, get things done in a faster accuracy. And it just takes me off and it helps me be on time as well. So, like, for example, if I have a deadline of, say, 9th of May, what I do is I take 2 days before that. I keep my personal deadline as 7th of May. So I finish doing things on 7th of May at a particular time. So then on 9th of May, I'm already ahead of time. So these are a few things that I wanted to share. Obviously, you can read more about it on my blogs or, you know, in general, Google yourself. And another important thing when I say volunteering, I just want to share this thing before I finish, is that when I start volunteering someplace, you don't expect a lot of things to happen, right? So the same thing happened with me with Ink. Ink is an organization just like TED, which does Ink shows where people from all across the world, you know, people from Tony Fadell, who's the founder of iPod, to let's say the Padman, everybody comes onto the stage and speaks about their accomplishments. So I started as a volunteer. I used to be a registration volunteer, like how you have it for IEEE conferences, right? You sit in the registration desk and you give lanyards and badges to people who come for the conference. So in my second year of college, I did this. Third year of my college, I again applied to be a volunteer. I did the same work. Fourth year of my college, they said, okay, she's been coming for 2 years. Why don't you manage volunteers? So all the volunteers who were selected for hospitality, for speaker management, for all of that, they came under me because I had done the event twice back to back. So they said, why don't you become the volunteer manager? And they paid me a stipend, a very small amount. And all the other volunteers get food and accommodation. So then, you know, that was a progress for me. Once I finished my college and started working, every time there was an in conference, they would call me to do small work. Like they'll call me as a paid intern, they'll call me as a paid consultant, they'll tell me to do speaker management. You know, eventually, by the time it was 2018, and as you see in the picture, it is 2019, I ended up speaking at the same conference.
I'm very sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to tell you that we were running out of time.
Yeah, I'm done. This is my last slide.
Okay. Sure.
So basically what happened to me was in that due process of time of becoming a volunteer, I eventually was able to learn new skills, gain new skills, and meanwhile also, you know, show my employers or potential employers of what I have in me. So from moving at the back of this stage to coming in front and being able to speak of it, it's been a long journey for me. And like, you know, the journey has always started with IEEE. IEEE was my opening, eye-opener from a college to become more professional and work with multiple brands and associate in a way that I gain out of it. And for me, what I tell people is that do not confine yourself, do everything that excites you, meet people, talk to them, you know, tell them your interesting stories, ask them about what excites them. And like, this is something that I believe that those who can do and those who can do more, they always volunteer. So that's all from my end. I really hope you had a very informative session. And in a way, you know, there's not a lot of things that I can give you as information because you have to take the information on your own. Like, you have to go there on the internet and figure out things and understand how you want to do things. So that's all from my end. I feel this was informative. If at all you have any questions, you can ask me here, or else you can reach out to me on any of my social media platforms and I shall respond to any of your queries. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, ma'am, for that wonderful session. Audience, may raise your questions if any. Aisha Shana has asked what the community is called.
Okay, so the community is called INC. It's an abbreviation to Innovation Network and Knowledge. INC is just like TED. The founder of INC used to be a co-host of TED that used to happen in US. So but when she retired from US, she came back to India and then she started this organization. It's a 11 years old organization. I'm sure if you just type INC talks or INC conference, you will see like all the people like the Padman or the, you know, there was a movie called Super 30 by Hrithik Roshan. So like, you know, all these stars were first identified by INC. And it's exactly like TED. However, TED is, it's just an Indian or let's say more of an Asian version of TED.
All right. So since there are no more questions left, let's head on. So participants, please do know that the link to the feedback form will be posted in the chat box. Make sure to fill it. Now I'd like to call upon Ms. Roshni V, Program Committee Coordinator, to deliver the vote of thanks. Over to you, Roshni.
Hello.
Yes, Roshni, you're audible.
Very good evening, all the pretty minds joined here. I'm Roshni, and this gives me an immense pleasure to deliver this session to give a word of thanks for this event. First of all, let me show my deepest gratitude to all dignitaries joined here. Let me get into my duty. Firstly, I'm thanking our speaker, Aisha ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for your valuable, inspirative, and informational session. Next, I would like to thank our Jamshir Ahmad, sir. I'm thanking.
Roshni?
I would like to thank our dear participants, students, members, IEEE volunteers, and last but not least, our beloved audience for making this function as a grand session. Once again, thank you all present here. Thank you.
So that brings us to the end of this wonderful session. Once again, I thank you, ma'am, for sparing your valuable time and joining us for this session. Have a nice day and take care. Audience, thank you again. Please do ensure to fill the feedback form. The link is posted in the comment section.
Participants can leave the meeting window once you have filled the feedback form.